Hello and welcome to another exciting and fascinating episode of Lab Insider. Here we'll be pushing the boundaries of lab innovations, especially in the field of bioinformatics. I'm joined here by Maximilians Wiens from Synefex in Germany. He'll be explaining everything there is to know about the recruitment process of new students and new workers, pandemic challenges, and a whole lot more. Right now, we're about to get into everything. Welcome, Max.
Thanks, Maximilian. I'm glad to be here.
It's great to have you on the show. We have a lot to talk about when it comes to recruitment of employees, project management, but I think we have quite a lot of areas to do with pharmaceutical and healthcare data integration as well.
Yes, definitely. So this is a very broad area and is one of the pretty actual hot topics in that industries where we are working on and where we help our customers to get their data right in the centralized place and to be, let's say, fair. This is a pretty modern term right now, to make it findable and reusable and so on. So this is where we help them to get faster on that road.
More to do with your company, actually. So you're associated with genomics and data integrations.
Yes, actually, the main part is the data integration. This is what we do on our daily basis.
Yes.
So we take a look at different vendors. We try to organize this data to make it convertible or even to convert in specific formats to establish some maybe even cloud-based approaches to collect the data, to retrieve the data back, and so on. So this is what we do. And besides that, we dive into the genomics area, but more or less obstructing the genomic data, because this is where also I initially came from the metagenomics area. And I think this is a very interesting area of research, which is pretty future-proof, even though it is not so covered in the current pharmaceutical industry. So there's more like proteomics and that kind of stuff. But I think this is also the future, and we try to get also on this train there.
You have mentioned that you're facing a balance between working on these kinds of projects and having the time to train the people, because this is a fast-moving industry.
Yes, it is. Yeah, definitely. So in regard to this, we are also collaborating with not only industrial partners, but also with universities to keep everyone on the same page and to say, okay, look, there's a lot of movement in the medical and in the pharmaceutical industry. There's a lot of new things and technologies upcoming. And we try to build, let's say, some associations there where everyone can join and say, okay, I like this new fair data format, for example, or I like to know more about how can I structure my data in the cloud, because this is also one of the main drivers currently in the industry to move data into the cloud and to be very flexible in terms of data processing, for example.
Yep.
And there we train the people also internally, but also we want to provide the documentation, we want to provide workshops for universities. I think the universities in that case are pretty, I would say, they're standing in the back of the queue, let's say, because universities are usually governmental paid, you know, and they do not have so much money as industrial partners, for example, right?
Right.
But they do their research, and I think there is a pretty cool benefit when you say, okay, we want to bring this forward, right? We want to make this also open. This is one of the parts, right? We want to open source some software when we do, for example, or some specifications. And here we can profit also from the universities, since they want to have it also done. They want to benefit from this. And they have a manpower. They have researchers and so on who is working there. And they can also contribute to such workshops, for example. Not only be a consumer, but also contribute. And this makes it even better for us than in the end.
There is a very notable process here, because when people think of these students entering into the workplace, this isn't someone that just graduated and suddenly, boom, they're looking for a job, right? And they sort of have to make their way and be able to contribute. You're looking at people who are in sort of their senior years at university to sort of transition into the workplace. Is that right?
Actually, what we're looking for sure, we're looking also for students there that we say, okay, someone who has a degree in bioinformatics, for example, right? They did already some research and so on, but this is completely different what you do at the university and when you move into let's say, GXP environmental things, or you move into the industrial areas where you have more organizational parts, you have more like workflows and some additional parts you would never find at the university, because this is very something what is very specific to the pharmaceutical industry or to biotech industry, right? And here we want to help them. And one of the things how we do this is that we have like some people who say, okay, I want to make my thesis at your company, and say, okay, I have a cool idea to do so, right? How can I do this? And we take those students and say, okay, you can write your thesis here, work on your idea, you can make your own research there, and then in that time, you will also learn the industrial aspects of this. And this is how we help them, let's say, to get both, the best of the both worlds, right? So that they make their own research and they also learn something from the industry.
Right. It does sound like the best of both worlds, because not only are they realizing their academic potential, but it seems like they're getting paid for it as well.
Yeah, for sure.
It seems like they do have to present a business case, though, to be able to realize this thesis, right? It's not just any kind of initiative that gets accepted.
So so we have some proposals, right? What to do, and because we know in which direction the industry is moving, or how could it be in the next few years, right? So that's for sure, that one student cannot make the one product in the very time box man, and then write a thesis about it and so on. This is too much, right? But what we can do, we can prove specific aspects of it and say, okay, we can make some studies in which are very time box and write about this, right? And in these studies, you will also apply this industrial things, like not only to prove your point of view, but also while you're proving this, use all the workflows and, for example, how the industrial people would work with this specific, let's say, mini program, for example, or mini tool.
When it comes to really organizing one's work, that's not something that students just have a problem with. You mentioned to me that if you have any, I'm not going to say regrets. Let's say the regrets. They're regrets. That project management was definitely something that you would have placed more focus on upon leaving the university.
Yes, I think in the university, at least what I saw when you also collaborate with students or you organize some students work at the university. I was working in one work group in metagenomics, especially, right? And what I took from that is, when you are a student in the university and you're working partially in a lab, or you're working at your computer where you analyze your data, right? You are a single worrier most of the time, right? You have your studies, you want to graduate, right? And you do your work. But after you join into the industry, you will realize pretty quick that this is a teamwork. You're not alone. You have to collaborate with different people. There are some organizational aspects about this. There are some procedures which you never know that they exist, right? And I think this, let's say, organizing part is not so clear at the universal studies, at least what I see, right? Or the students are just saying, okay, this is just a subject like any another, but I don't really like it. It's just about blah, blah, management stuff. I don't care, right? I just want to code, right? Give me some data. And I think it must be clear for students that they are not alone after they leave the university. They will work in the team. And I think this organizational project management part is very important for the future. It is not, maybe not so important while you're studying, because you are on your own. Only your work does count for your grades. But afterwards, the work of the whole team counts. And there you need to be able to work in the team properly. And when you already know some structures, let's say Scrum or Kanban or whatever, or how you want to organize it, right? And that when you know how it works and you have already experience with this, this is very important for the future.
Do you think that's, is that being remedied right now? Or do you think that students still need to learn project management, the new generation?
So they're already learning this, right? But I think the students must focus on it. And I see that there are some universities, for example, just to compare, which do more, nothing has to do with the lab, but only informatics. They learn a lot more about that rather than research-focused universities where you have like bioinformatics or chemical informatics and so on. They do not have it so much focus on it, but I think it will be more and more, it will come more and more to the lab. Those agile methods and so on, they are already there. And I think in a few years, we will see this even more, since when you see this in a pandemic, for example, right, where everyone is working from home and you analyze your data from home, somehow you need to work remotely, right? You need somehow to organize it also. It's not just you come into your office or into your lab. It is completely different situation here. And I think those organizational methods or new organizational methods must be learned. And I think when you learn them earlier and you have more experience with this, the more successful you will collaborate in the end, in the lab, when you join the industry.
When working with large troves of data, whether it's big or small, one thing that really does come to mind is integrity and security. Obviously, a company can sort of keep everything safe if it's under one roof. But when we start spreading our devices around into, you know, to our homes or hotel Wi-Fis, airport Wi-Fi, we begin to worry that data could be compromised. Is this something that's is this a challenge that you've been facing?
It is definitely, especially when you try to place your data in the cloud somewhere, right? So usually, so the trustworthiness, let's say, for the cloud providers, it depends from company to company, definitely. But when it comes to very sensitive data, there are a lot of aspects which you need to take a look on before you store something in the cloud rather than on your local disks, right? And there are also some different, let's say, different procedures which you can do. For example, the GMP environment, you could do the we follow the Alcoa Plus, for example, for our data integrity. So this is like a guideline to achieve that. And what you could do, we do this in our cloud, and you need to make sure that you have the traceability, that no one can access else, that you have only specific access and you have your restrictions there. But on the other hand side, you want to make the researcher free for their data analysis. That means you need to provide some computational environment somehow, right? That they maybe can compute the data at the same place where the data is located. That they don't need to download this, and you need, let's say, only the remote desktop kind of, right? And this trend, what I see not only in the industrial world, but also in the research world. For example, when we talk about, we recently talked about Elixir and also about the Elixir partnership with Denby, the German network for bioinformatics infrastructure, which combines different universities. And they said, we want also to provide these capabilities to our lab workers to say, they generate the data and they can directly process the data where it's stored. And this is done, for example, that you have a remote desktop access. This is a very simple thing. You have a remote desktop access and you have your virtual machine with all the tools that you need. You don't need to install something locally, etc. You just say, I want that kind of analysis, and you have all the tools already there in place, installed, configured properly, and you can directly begin with your research.
It sounds like the ultimate solution. Obviously, everything into one device, take it wherever you go. Are there technical limitations or demands? Do people need a better device to be able to handle such programs?
Yeah, for sure. So the technical limitations, so you have a different aspect. The one, you have a lab, which is, let's say, completely on-prem, somewhere, right? It is behind 1,000 firewalls. And if you want to connect this to the cloud, you need somehow to drill a hole into this firewall.
Yeah, literally,
right?
Yes. Well, I mean, you need to get in there and go through some servers are in gates. You need to make your way through.
Exactly. And this is where the whole thing begins already, all those security things, right? No one lets you just drill a hole into a firewall, right? And on the other hand side, even that you get and you say, you have from this instrument to this endpoint, you have your data channel, for example, right? How do you make it sure that the data, what you have here, is transferred there and this data is completely the same? Right, you need to make also this sure, and that you make this traceable. The data was copied there. That everyone knows, right? And this was copied by Maximilian, for example, to that place at this time, right? That kinds of things, which come not only the data what you need, but you need also this, let's say, metadata around this to be copied and so on to be stored somewhere. And this is also challenging because sometimes you have very, very crazy limitations, and you need to find a solution how to do this, how to provide the security here, right? And but from the computational point of view, it is not a big problem because when you're in the cloud, you usually have a lot of resources to do so, right? You need just to restrict them to specific users, for example, or to specific purposes and so on. But on the other hand side, you need to make it traceable also in the cloud. Usually for on-prem, you would have those mechanisms already in place because every pharmaceutical company works with this.
Yeah.
Right? but you need to establish the same thing in the cloud. So that means you either need additional kind of software which makes all those traces and so on, or you use the cloud native solution somewhere if it's possible, right? But these are, you cannot just take a cloud and do this. So this is, let's say, a technical limitation, that case that you need some time to establish this first, the whole infrastructure there, before you really can begin. Right.
Sometimes people make the easy connotation that youth equals innovation, right? That the younger are more tech fluent and able to get into these solutions. Do you find that people jumping into digital solutions, using the cloud, managing this data, are they more adept when they're younger, or is it the same all around?
You have two sides of the coin, right? So the one part is the openness to the innovation, how open the people are to learn something new. And if they see that, okay, I need this for the future of my job, for example, right? And on the other hand side are those experiences which you made, but this experience you can make only over the time when you already had a lot, when you have already experience in your job, you worked for several years and so on. Right, and to combine both, I think this is the ideal thing, where you say, okay, I'm pretty open-minded for the new innovations, for new things. Maybe to say, okay, I am a biologist. I was studying biology back in the time, and I was just working in the lab the whole time. But now I see that learning Python, for example, would be very helpful for me, because currently the biologists are also data scientists. Well, there's a transformation in my area.
There has to be, yeah.
But when you stay conservative and you say, okay, well, I just want to do my things, and this is maybe not the most optimal thing what you will do, right? On the other hand side, new students, they usually, when you take an bioinformatics research or the genomics, they already thought, so, okay, you need informatics. You will not get around this. So, and they already doing this, right? Because it's pretty clear that informatics will be, I think, in very pretty every aspect of life sciences in the end. And you need to have even basic understanding of data analysis, or even plotting, just plotting things and write some script, right? On that hand side, they are pretty open for this, because they know this will be the future, and they already told in the universities, okay, and they worked already in the universities, maybe like basic Python course for biodata analysis, for example, and they know, but their lack of experience. On the other hand side,
and that's where you come in.
Comes with the time, and I think they have the best things. But this is already a good part when they are open-minded for new stuff. Right?
It's a good step. Yeah, obviously, attitude is everything, right?
Yeah, and I think so. The ideal thing is when you already have some experience, maybe, and you're open-minded, and you try to always challenge yourself and say, okay, I want to learn something new, right? And to learn some new things also in your spare time, if you're curious. But for this, you need to love what you're doing. And I think this is very important, so that you say, okay, what I do is pretty cool. I want to learn more. I want to dive deeper in specific topics, and that you say, okay, why not to learn that and that, because it's cool and because I like it. And I think this will contribute also to the job.
Thank you. Thank you. Maximilian from Synefex, thank you for joining us. That was Maximilian Wiens from Synefex in Germany. Join us for another episode of Lab Insider.